A very good evening to all of you.
Good
this is Dr. E. Jaspal from Department of Anthropology, Pondicherry University, Pondicherry. Well, today I'm going to discuss about a very sensitive issue called as COVID-19. As we all know that this particular disease, disorder, conditions, are just so many things that created a lot of disturbances, not only in India, but almost complete earth, and which forced us to think a lot about our current scenario. Before moving further, let me first give you a glimpse of informations about what it is. COVID-19, what we call it as a coronavirus disease 2019, is a global pandemic that has already resulted in hundreds of thousands of infections and thousands of deaths, with many, many more anticipated. As we all know that it was discovered in 2019, and is responsible for a global pandemic. COVID-19 is caused by a virus called as SARS-CoV-2, or it is also called as acute respiratory syndrome or coronavirus 2. Because it is genetically similar to SARS or SARS-CoV-2, which was responsible for the SARS outbreak in 2002. Now, coronavirus that circulate among humans are typically benign, and they cause about a quarter of all common cold illnesses. In COVID-19, what happened is that there was a coronavirus initially circulated among bat, which are natural animal reservoir that seems to have mutated and ultimately started causing disease in humans. The outbreak began in China, but has since spread around the world. As of 1st April 2020, or roughly 4 months into the outbreak, there has been a millions of confirmed cases and so many deaths, resulted in a fatality rate of approximately 5%. However, current studies suggest that the actual fertility rate is likely to be a little bit lower, around 0.7%. The reason is for this is that there are a lot of undiagnosed COVID-19 cases, which makes the actual number of cases go up. Many of them, these are asymptomatic carriers. This can be as high as 25% of the cases. So there is an important issue that we have learned. There are many lessons to be learned from this. And there are many countries have responded to the disease. Explore this. Let us use an epidemic curve, which was drawn between the number of cases and time. Means as the number of cases increases, the curve increases, it reaches to its higher level, and suddenly after a certain period of time, when it fulfills all conditions, then it retards back. And there is a horizontal line. The horizontal line, it is called as a capacity of healthcare systems that is altogether depend on the status of healthcare capacity that account for the things like number of beds available, ventilators, as well as the number of healthcare workers present. And resources like personal protective equipment or PPE that have
available.
Usually the healthcare system is working near full capacity. So with a pandemic like COVID-19 break out, even a relatively small increase in number of patients can overwhelm the healthcare system. Now, if you see, so there are two strategies to tackle. First, to flatten the curve of increase of number of cases. And second, to raise the line of this horizontal line, which is called increasing healthcare capacity. So in order to flatten the curve is focus on diminishing the total number of people that get sick and slows down the rate at which people get sick. While raising the line, that is horizontal line, that helps to actually increase healthcare capacity. Let's take a look at different countries, apply these two strategies, starting with the originated place from the side. The first country to deal with COVID-19. China informed the World Health Organization about COVID-19 on 31st December 2009. A few weeks later, on January 24, China aggressively tried to flatten the curve and by placing a major lockdown. We started with the Hubei provinces and then issue a similar lockdown in other region within China. They in fact started taking action for the resident to stay at home except for essential activities like going to the pharmacy or getting groceries. Non-essential business and schools were shut down. Public transportation was shut down and roads between the cities were blocked off. Going even further, some communities even forced a system by which there was only one entrance and exit and everyone passing through was screened for symptoms. If anyone in the community tested positive, the entire community might be quarantined. In all, this affected 15 cities and about 57 million people. The measures was so swiftly enacted and strictly enforced. And 12 days later, that is on 5th February, the exponential growth broke and the number of new cases started to fall off. Similarly, in due course of time, they started building many hospitals that were developed and they started made the effort to raise the line. First, by building multiple hospitals, which is totally dedicated to COVID-19 patients. They started taking several doctor or health professional from less affected regions of the country to staff this hospital and kept them protected with well-designed PPE that covered them from head to toes. By March, the economy began to return to the normal and was seeing more cases of COVID-19 from travelers than from their own citizens. If we take the example of South Korea, which took slightly different, equally effective strategy. In order to flatten the curve, pandemic curve, they implemented mass testing that was free, easy, and accessible. They offered drive-through testing station where people were tested inside the car and also had phone booth like area where the person walks in, get tested and walked out. South Korea was performing 50,000 tests per day and by March 20th, I will give you the the recent data also, they had tested around 317,000 people out of a population of 51 million. Now the condition is much more better, which worked out to be 1 out of 162 people. People were tested positive were either sent to a hospital if their symptoms were severe, or to a quarantine facility if the symptoms were more mild. At the same time, public health workers conducted contact tracing for every case to track down individuals that might have been exposed to the virus. So, South Korea had such a thorough understanding of who did and didn't have COVID-19 and where they had been. The lockdown was effectively done at the level of the sick individual rather than at the societal level like in China. Given this, given the forewarning that South Korea had about the disease and the aggressive effort around case identification, their healthcare system was well prepared for the patient and had the resource to keep healthcare workers safe. Now, if you take the case of a United States, which had the most cases in the entire world, where the number of cases continue to rise weekly. In terms of testing, the US lags far behind South Korea, that is out of one out of every 2024 case people, roughly 15 times less than South Korea, despite both countries have their first confirmed cases on January 19, one in the state of Washington and other in Seoul, Korea. So in addition to the absence of widespread testing to identify which individual need to be isolated, only some US states have mandated a lockdown, and when it's been applied, there has been minimal enforcement. So in sum, without a federal mandate or enforcement of a lockdown, it's been largely a scattered state by state effort that has been largely been voluntary. So if you see the whole scenario, in the case of US, the healthcare workers generally have inadequate PPE, especially N95, to feel safe. And as a result of hundreds of physicians and nurses have gotten ill or been quarantined. Meanwhile, intensive care unit or ICU beds have started to run out. Ventilators are expected to be in short supply, and there have been runs on medication supply, cardiochloroquine. Unfortunately, in the context of having healthcare resources, we know that mortality rate can be quite high. Meaning that small risk rather than volunteer, so that the actual number of people abide by can stop the spread of COVID-19 within a matter of days. In a country that is seeing exponential growth like the United States, to show how this works, let's start with a community that is already seeing an exponential growth in COVID-19 cases. Haven't even begun seeing symptoms. There are two questions at this point. Two questions you will see at this point. The first case is where we have a continuous distancing. Here, policies are still ahead while others continue to throw pool parties, keep business open, invite people. In that scenario, then with the taste of intention, clean, proper precautions, we cannot control the exponential growth as we have seen in the first chart. causing hospital to fill up with patients and many people will die. But now if we consider the second case, where we can say that enforced lockdown. There is enforced lockdown with absolutely everyone confined to their home. If there was that to happen, the virus could spread to household contact. But after that, the transmission would abruptly end. As this infected people recover with no access to new host, the virus has to place to go. And within 2 weeks, the number of new cases started to fall. So, we have to take a very special example of Hubei region, where the lockdown is followed the option 2. The rate of new cases decreased within a few days of the lockdown. People
remember
and remember the doctor that decreases the curve. The decrease was seen about 2 weeks later in terms of fewer new cases coming to the hospital. The bottom line is voluntary social distancing is only as effective as the number of people who practice it. If enough people don't adhere, then the virus can continue to spread and the pandemic breaks out, ultimately resulting in more death. We have seen a number of important countries, developed countries. They are really facing that problem. Fortunately, to some extent, we anyhow manage it, but still it has. It is about its relation with mortality. The data shows that COVID-19 mortality rate differ by group. So, for example, if you split things out by ages, the fatality rate is relatively low if you are below 60, with no death or very limited death or cases seen in the children of a 9 and young, but then start to really climb up for elderly. So they are really the ones at the highest risk. Similarly, the fertility rate is higher for those group of people who are suffering from hypertension, diabetic, cardiovascular diseases, chronic respiratory diseases, and cancer, along with the relative to the folk without any of these conditions. And of course, the elderly are more likely to have
a condition.
So it's not surprising that they go hand in
hand.
There is another exception, and so many discussion is coming out nowadays. If you open the media, you'll find there is so many discussion related to that, related to the pregnant people. And the data, even though it's very limited, but it seems like healthy pregnant peoples are not at risk for developing serious diseases. And to date, there haven't been reported cases of transmission of COVID-19. The virus also was not detected
in a
small group of mothers with COVID-19. And in terms of breastfeeding, the main risk would still be from droplets rather than breastfeeding itself. Now, overall, based on the current data, nearly over 80% of the patients with COVID-19 have mild infection, and some people don't develop any symptoms at all. For others, they can develop mild symptoms like we have seen, we knew about this thing like fever, cough, shortness of breath. But there are other symptoms like fatigue, loss of smell and taste, serious problems like pneumonia, acute respiratory distress syndromes or ARDS, which occur when the lung inflammation is so severe that fluid built up around within the lungs. The severe infection can cause septic shock, which happen when the blood pressure falls dramatically and the body organs start for oxygen. ARDS are acute respiratory distress syndromes, and shock are the main cause of death in the case of COVID-19. Finally, it's worth noting that even folks that don't die from COVID-19, including young and healthy individuals, they can go on to develop pulmonary fibrosis, which is known to be a chronic lung condition that severely impaired a person's quality of life. In addition to causing disease, coronavirus can spread quickly. It is increasingly clear that a lot of spread is occurred through pre-symptomatic people, that is those group of people that are in the incubation period, many of whom are not at high risk themselves. It also is spread from those with symptoms, like when people cough or sneeze, and tiny droplets containing the virus. These droplets can land at the person's mouth, nose, or eyes, and then allow the virus to enter the new person. So generally, it's usually spread over a long distance here, but they can get flung from one person to another on the droplets of saliva when someone's cough or sneeze. Recent studies suggested that SARS-CoV-2 airborne droplets can remain infectious for up to 3 hours. In addition, this virus can also survive on surfaces, like it can survive up to 8 hours on latex and aluminium, up to 24 hours on cardboard, up to three days on countertops or plastics and stainless steels, up to 5 days on wood and glass. So make sure you clean and sterilize frequently touched surfaces like phones, keyboard, door handles, and toilet seat with alcohol-based cleaning wipes. Once a person is infected, symptoms develop about 5 days later. This is called incubation period. Now there is a debate about how much asymptomatic people are pre-symptomatic group that are in the incubation period are spreading the disease. And it may be much more than what was originally thought. Generally, we all know that viruses are given a reproductive number or are not based on how quickly they spread. R0 of 1, it means that an infected person passes it on to one new person. Similarly, a R0 of 2 means that one person spread it to two new people and so forth. If the R0 is below 1, the infection peters out. But if it is 1, it stays steady. And if it is above 1, then it continues to spread. The current estimate for COVID-19 is an R0 is R of 2.2. Means, as a point of comparison, the R0 of flu virus is about 1.3. That is quite common. But in case of coronavirus, it is spread quite a bit more easily in comparison to flu or any other as such viral disorder disease concern. If we see the worldwide scenario, so number of cases as per the record on 25th April, it is about more than 28 lakhs. And in that context, the condition of India, it to some extent is quite reasonable, controllable, and appreciable. Because of the active steps and systematically proper steps taken by our government, we have to really thank them, because India being a developing country, such a large population, such a diverse population, such a distant diversion, still we managed to control it, curtail it in such a beautiful manner that some of the important, well-developed, developed countries, they failed to do so. If you see this particular survey report or information, India is far, far somewhat comfortable in comparison to America, Spain, Italy, France, Germany, UK, Turkey, Iran, China, and so on. As we all know that, India witnessed an outbreak of this coronavirus, which is known to be COVID-19 or SARS-CoV-2, in late January 2020, when three Indian students traveled to the southern state of Kerala from Wuhan in China, which is known to be the epicenter of the outbreak. All three of them tested positive for COVID-19, confirming a local contagion. At the same time, several other cases were detected in other parts of the country, most of which were linked to people with a travel history to affected countries, means it came from outside. Similarly, if you see the report or current data of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare related to COVID-19, till today, that is 27th April 2020 at morning 8 a.m., there was about 20,835 active cases, 6,185 cured or discharged, and 872 death. And here is the comparison of state and city of India with COVID-19. We all know that the large state, biggest state like Maharashtra, Delhi, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, West Bengal, they are really facing a big problem, and they have to think about either increasing the horizontal line or decreasing the epidemiological curve in such a manner to control or retain it, retard it. If you discuss about its real scenario in this case, we can say that it is a polymerase chain reaction to confirm the diagnosis. A reverse transcription polymerase chain reactions, or what is called a RT-PCR test, can be done, which can detect very small amount of viral RNA. It is worth mentioning, however, that early in the disease, the RT-PCR can often mix the infection intentions altogether, meaning then it's not very sensitive. So if severe pulmonary disease, in the case of severe pulmonary disease is suspected, a test CT can be done to help detect the presence of a viral pneumonia. Next, the liver, which is rapid test for COVID-19, can get the virus within a minute. One of these is isothermal amplification, which also check for viral RNA. The other is rapid serological testing, which we have started now, which check for the antibodies created by the immune system to fight the virus. This is checking for the antibodies made by the body. It can detect previous even after the virus is. Finally, it's also important to look for other causes of similar symptoms. We discuss treatment. Individuals with mild symptoms should isolate themselves at home so that they can protect themselves from food and heat. For those with severe treatment, such as providing fluid and ventilator support for really ill people. There is early data showing that remdesivir and antiviral drugs used against Ebola. Other medications that have been used to try to treat severe COVID-19 include a combination of lantiviral and ritonavir.
Both
of which are antiretroviral drugs. As well as chloroquine and
hydrochloroquine,
which treat malaria, with one trial showing effectiveness of hydrochloroquine and being used. I try to conclude the or the whole lecture or whole webinar. So we all know that it started.
ये பரந்திரியல பண்ண வேண்டாம்
கோவிட் 19 pandemic country around the world had
you தண்ணி குடிச்சு கொரோனா புடிச்சு
then containing the
எங்க வந்து வந்து பேஸ்ட் ஆன வேல வெச்சிருவாங்களோட சும் ஓடி ஓடி
கட்டறானப்பா the number of new cases immense lockdown at our federal level to enforce social distancing and mass testing are key component to preventing the spread of the disease. While raising the line can be accomplished by training more frontline healthcare workers, building more hospitals, providing hospital staff with adequate PPE, treatments are focused on supportive care, and the number of medications are in a clinical trial. There may be a vaccine ready in 2021 as far as the WHO is concerned. For individual, the best strategy is prevention. This includes staying isolated, careful hand washing, and avoiding touching your T-zone. If you are a healthcare worker, you should use personal protective measures. These are the important sources that we use in order to prepare this particular webinar. Thank you so much.